Hello, my name is David Luckenbaugh. I'm a statistician with the Office of Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion here at NIH in the Office of the Director. I want to welcome you to a conversation about reliability and measurement in clinical trials. The first thing we need to do as we're talking here is just define our objective. Our objective is to understand reliability of measurement as it fits into a clinical trial. In order to understand reliability, the first thing we need to do is to talk about what a construct is. So a construct is a theoretical concept. It could be a concept like depression or mental health. It could be something like a biological measure, or it could be something much more theoretical. A construct is necessary to understand the measurement process because we need to measure something. The construct is the something that we're going to measure. So measurement is a system of defining the level of a construct. Often we talk about in clinical research using an operational definition. An operational definition is a method used for examining some kind of domain. Have you ever considered when you go to do something the first time, it's a unique experience, but then when you go to do it again, it's not quite the same? Well, when we talk about whether something is consistent from one point to the next, we talk about reliability. So reliability can come up in any kind of different field. It could be in depression, where you have multiple different kinds of rating scales. It could be in other fields that study tremors, where you might have something that's rated by a judge or by a computer. Or you might have heart disease, where you might measure cholesterol, C-reactive protein, the number of heart attacks. So reliability is the consistency with which you measure any of these different events. So consistency, if you look on the screen and see the slide with the target, consistency is the fact that a lot of these balls that have hit the target are almost on top of each other. You're getting a fairly consistent throw from the person who's in the corner of the screen. In order to have good reliability, you don't have to necessarily hit the target. As long as you are consistently hitting a certain space, that space is, you would consider, you would be working reliably if you're consistently hitting the same point. So on the left, you have a place where you're hitting the target constantly. The second circle, you have where you're hitting consistently the same space, but it's off target. Even though it's off target, we can still call it reliable because you're going to the same space. In the third target, you see the balls all over the place. So that would be an unreliable throw. So there's several different types of reliability. One of them is internal consistency reliability. In internal consistency reliability, we want to understand how consistent the different items on a scale are from one to the next. So in depression scales, for example, you may have 12 items on the scale. You want to be sure that they're measuring something consistent, something similar. There needs to be something similar about each of the items in order for that to make sense. To the degree that they are consistent, you have internal consistency reliability. In inter-rater reliability, you have from one rater to the next, you might get the same score. So a good example of this is if you take the Olympics, gymnastics at one point in time was one of the primary examples. You have a rater who gives a score for a gymnast, and then you'll have another person who gives another rating. And if you're lucky, they give fairly similar ratings. To the degree that they're similar, you have inter-rater reliability. In a different situation, you may be looking at the same rater over a period of time. When you're looking over a period of time, you want to call this test-retest reliability. So essentially, you're making a rater rate multiple times. So if you would, take out a pencil or a pen and draw a circle. Once you finish the circle, draw a second circle. What do the two look like? Did you draw the same exact circle? Are they the similar size? Did you draw one inside of the other? Did you draw one around the other? To the degree that you have exactly the same circle, you have reliably measured circles. So the reason that we talk about reliability is that it can lead to a lot of different kinds of problems. All of these problems introduce some kind of error in your measurement. So when you have error in your measurement, you have less sensitive statistics. That means it's harder to find significance even in the same situation. So the more error that you have, the more difficulty you're going to have with your statistics. You also need a larger sample size. You'll need more people as you have more error in your data. And ultimately, if you have the worst situation where you have tremendously unreliable data, then you'll have uninterpretable results that you won't be able to make any sense of. So let's for a minute talk about how this works, how reliability coefficients work with sample size. So reliability coefficients are measured like a Pearson correlation. So you have one as your very best and zero as your worst. So in this case, and in fact in pretty much all situations where you estimate sample size, the assumption is that you have perfect reliability. So if I wanted to do a new study and that study required a moderate effect size with 80% power, what you would need with perfect reliability is 128 subjects in your study. So then let's say that you go down to 0.8, so your reliability has dropped 0.2 points. What will happen then is instead of needing just 128 participants, you now need 200. So fairly quickly, as you see the reliability coefficient drop, you need much more in terms of sample size. You have about, if you get down as far as 0.4, which would be really unreliable, you would need almost 800 people in your study in order to find the same kind of effect. So you can see how this can be a real problem. Generally, a good reliability coefficient is about 0.7 to 0.9. The higher, the better, as you can see from this scale here. So again, this is from a between groups study. For those of you who might be interested in the exact numbers for 128, that would be 64 people per group in a two-group study. So there are some things that you can do. There was a great article a number of years ago by Helena Kramer who talked about how you can improve reliability without improving the sample size. So one of the biggest things here is coming up with standardized procedures. So SOPs or standard operating procedures are exactly what you want here. If you can put down exactly how somebody should perform a rating, then they're more likely to be able to do it consistently because they can refer back to the standards. So this is probably the primary way that people try to standardize, probably to try to improve reliability, is just by setting up a set of SOPs. Second, you can train raters. So for example, let's say that you have nurses who are working on rating depression patients. What you can do if you want reliability from one rater to the next is that you can train them to follow the rating scale in the same way. So if they have questions about what does anhedonia mean, for example, then you can explain to them exactly how you want them to interpret a particular question, and then they'll be able to use those guidelines in order to make the best ratings. The other thing that you can do, and this goes along with training, is once you've done training, you might monitor raters. A lot of times you see large studies monitor at every 6 months or every year, but you do get some drift. As soon as you finish your training, what you'll see happen is that the raters will get less and less reliable. So the more often you monitor your raters, the more often you go back and make sure they're following the same procedures, the better off your data is going to look, the more reliability you'll have. Another thing you can try is you can try using multiple raters for any specific rater. What can happen here is that as you take the average for different raters, you actually get a more reliable result than if you just took any one particular score. Another thing you can do that's sort of like having multiple raters is you can take repeated observations. So instead of having a rater rate just one time, you can have them rate multiple times. So in a lot of clinical trials, you'll see where raters rate at individual time points. Instead of rating just one time point, maybe beginning and end, they'll rate maybe for your study, it might be every week or every month or every year even, I've seen. So repeated observations helps to reduce the amount of error that you pick up that's due to that may not explain the effect that you have in mind. So again, providing standard procedures, training raters, monitoring raters, using multiple raters for each rating, and then taking repeated observations are all ways that you can improve your study. So as a summary, reliability is consistency in measurement. Reliability affects the sample size required for the study, and reliability can be improved with relatively simple alterations to the measurement process. Finally, I have a couple questions for you that you might think about in going back and reviewing your notes here. One is to name one method for improving reliability. A second is, does weak reliability influence the outcome of statistical analysis? Thank you very much for listening today. I appreciate your being an audience member. If you have any questions, please contact the program coordinator for this program. Thank you.